stand with me and turn your Bible to the second epistle of the beloved Apostle John. Second John. If you have difficulty finding it, go to the back of the New Testament, start in the back. It's right back in the book of the Revelation, just before 3 John and the book of Jude. Second John. I want to begin reading verse 1. The elder unto the elect lady and her children, whom I love in the truth, and not I only, but also all they that have known the truth. For the truth's sake, which dwelleth in us and shall be with us forever, grace be with you, mercy and peace from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, in truth and love. I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in truth, as we have received a commandment from the Father. And now I beseech thee, lady, not as though I wrote a new commandment unto thee, but that which we have from the beginning, that we love one another. And this is love, that we walk after his commandments. This is the commandment that, as ye have heard from the beginning, ye should walk in. For many deceivers are entered into the world, who confess not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. This is the deceiver and an antichrist. Look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have brought, but that we receive a full reward. Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you, and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him God speed. If he that biddeth him God speed is partaker of his evil deeds. Have many things to write unto you, I would not write them with paper and ink, but I trust to come unto you and speak face to face, that our joy may be full. The children of thy elect sister greet thee. Amen. The Lord has blessed me upon his word to be sanctified in the hearts and minds of the people of God. Let us pray, shall we? Father, we thank you for your word, for the instant of your word gives light. And then we pray that your Holy Spirit will illumine our hearts and our minds, we will behold glorious, magnificent, and splendid truth from your law. Speak to us to the end that sinners might say, what must I do to be saved? That backsliders might be reclaimed, that the saints might be revived, and that we might all leave this place rejoicing together because of the good hand of God. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Since many of you do not get the opportunity to come out on Wednesday night, what's that? Is anybody mistaken? You don't get the opportunity to come. Since you don't get the opportunity to come, I thought that I would take this opportunity bring just a slice of Wednesday night to you, because we have a great and a wonderful time as we gather together around the word of the Lord and break down in smaller groups and share, and we read and study the Bible together. And after leading the service this past Wednesday, my heart just was so filled as I heard the people of God discuss the insights that God shared them from this particular passage, and many things I had not seen before as I read this passage, and I thought that I would just bring back some of those thoughts to you this morning, because I thought it was a timely word that spoke to my own heart, and I think it spoke to the heart of many who were here on Wednesday night, and I trust that God will use it to speak to you. This small, tiny postcard, and it's all often referred to, 2 John, 13 verses, written by the Apostle John, one of the 12 whom Jesus had selected. One who was a member of Jesus' inner circle, of Peter, James, and then there was John. One who referred to himself and the gospel of the same name, the gospel of John, he refers to himself as the apostle whom Jesus loved. It's the same John who knelt and who placed his shoulder, his head on Jesus' breast and asked him, Lord, who is it that's going to betray you? The same John who knelt at the foot of the cross when Jesus was hanging there in his agony, and John was there. He was there with the mother of Jesus, and Jesus says to his mother, behold your son. And your child be holding your mother, the same John who took the responsibility and care for the earthly mother of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's this John who's writing this epistle. He's writing this epistle because he is a pillar of the early church. He's one of the leaders. He's one of those few who have been hand-picked by the Lord Jesus, has spent 3.5 years being taught by the Lord Jesus Christ. He had been privy to the insight that Jesus had shared only to those in his inner circle, explaining to them the parables and the mysteries of the kingdom of God. Now John is an aged one now, an aged apostle, and who had great and hope that Christ would return quickly after his ascension. Now John maybe is settling in and realizing that maybe there will be some time that will pass, and maybe he himself will not see the second coming of Christ. And so John is wanting to anchor the people of God. He wants to anchor them in biblical truth. He wants to anchor them so they will not be tossed to and fro and driven by every doctrine, the slight-handedness of men. He wants them to be able to recognize the truth from error. And so he's moved by the Holy Spirit to pen this letter. As I shared with our class on Wednesday night, I personally do not believe that when the writers of the biblical text wrote the biblical text, they knew they were writing the biblical text. I do not think that they knew they were writing things that would be preserved and that would become a part of the canon of scripture that we would have as the Bible. I believe they felt a strong compulsion of the Lord to write and to share and to warn and to give instructions, but I do not believe they knew we're writing something that's going to be contained in the Bible for the New Testament church. That's my personal insight. They are writing to real people in real places, real situations, and real circumstances. And God, in his infinite wisdom, is able to take situations and circumstances that existed at a place and time in history to speak with specificity to those individuals, but because it is God who's given the word, he's also to speak revelation that will have timeless truth. And so here they are in the first century dealing with truth and error and false teachers and those who are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ and cults who are rising up around the church. They're dealing with all that in their day and time. And so John is moved by the Spirit of God to write. And so what John wrote to them is also applicable for us because we're dealing with similar times, similar situations and circumstances. Are you following?
Amen.
And so the Bible itself is not designed to be a cookbook with recipes, but the Bible serves as a guidebook with timeless truth. And as we pray, as we seek the face of God, then God can speak to us from the timeless principles that's in the text.
Amen.
That's important for us to understand. Amen. And with that as a backdrop, let's look at the text. Now, the scholars are divided as to whom John was writing, because in many of the New Testament letters, the writer will identify his audience in the beginning of the letter, either an individual, as Paul does in the book of Acts, when he writes to Theophilus, or to a church congregation, as Paul does in letters to the churches of Galatia or Philippi or so forth. Peter, to the strangers who are scattered. So we know that Peter's writing to Christians who have been scattered because of the persecution. But John somewhat veils the audience, the direct specific audience, and he refers to this audience as the elect lady. There are two schools of thought. One is that John is writing to an individual, a female whom he knows personally, and that she has a church that meets in her home, and her own biological children are members of their congregation. And the second school of thought, that John is using the term elect lady figuratively or as a metaphor to describe the church. I personally am inclined to believe the latter. I believe that we are referred to as the elect of God, the church referred to as the bride of Christ, and John is sort of building on that idea that as the elect bride of Christ, he's writing. So I believe that he's writing to a church, a specific church in a specific place somewhere near and around Ephesus, and to the members or the children of their congregation. Notwithstanding whether you ascribe to the position as a person or is it to a church, the timeless principles are still applicable. Are you following?
Amen.
It does not change the interpretation or the application of the text, because when you see what he's talking about the importance of the church really being a champion for the truth. But look at what he says. The elder unto the elect lady and her children, whom I love in the truth, and not only I, but also all they that have known the truth, for the truth's sake, which dwelleth in us and shall be with us forever. The first thing that I would like to lift from the text, I think that John is suggesting to us, is that there should be a response that the church has to the truth, a response that we have to the truth. And our response to the truth should be a love for the truth. We should love the truth for the truth's sake. We should love the truth because it's the truth. There should be love for the truth. Jesus said in John chapter 8, if you continue in my word, then you shall be my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. So our response to the truth should be a love for the truth, and we also should have a hunger and a desire to know the truth. He says, for the truth shall set you free, the truth shall make you free. And so John says, I love you in the truth, but not only do I love you, all those who have known the truth. And so the truth becomes that which binds the people of God together. It binds us together across time and across space. Our love for the truth and our knowledge of the truth and our seeking of the truth binds us together. And that's why as the people of God, we can go to a foreign country where they have the Bible and we not even know the language. But through the benefit of an interpreter, someone in a foreign country can speak the truth of God and be interpreted to us, and it resonates with us. This is the truth. It is the truth not only because that person is saying it, it's the truth because it resonates inside of you. So John says to the church, we must respond favorably in our love toward the truth and our desire to know the truth. And that's why there's no replacement for Bible study. Not just Bible reading, but Bible study. And we study the Bible together. We study the text. We analyze the text. We investigate the text to try to understand the meaning of the text so that we can know the truth. Amen. So John says our response to the truth should be to love it, to know it, to desire it. Jeremiah says, thy word was found, I did eat them, and thy word was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. So we should love it, we should want to know it, and look at what else he says, we should abide in it. For the truth's sake, for it dwelleth in us, and shall be with us forever. And so we should allow the truth to abide in us, and we should abide in it. Did Jesus not say in John chapter 15, if ye continue in my word, he says, you can ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. If you abide in me, he says in John 15, and my word abide in you, then you can ask what you will. The truth becomes that which informs our minds about the will of God. It informs our mind about the will of God. It shapes our thinking about the character and about the nature of God. And so when our mind is informed by the will of God and about the nature and about the character of God, then in our human minds, we can start entertaining thoughts that are like God's thoughts. And then we can start praying prayers that are consistent with the will of God and with the word of God. And we can know that we're praying according to the will of God. And so it is impossible for us to pray. It is impossible for us to know that we are praying consistent with the will of God apart from the word of God. It's impossible. And so that's one of the reasons John says our response to the truth should be to love it, to know it, to allow it to abide in us, and we abide in it. Look at what he says. If we respond properly to it, then there are certain results that we will experience from it. Verse 3, grace be with you, mercy and peace from God the Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, in truth and love. When we respond properly to the truth, to love it, to know it, to allow it to abide in us and we in it, then there are certain results that we can experience. We experience God's grace, and we talked about that last time. We talked about this unmerited, unearned, undeserved favor that we experience, called the grace of God. And so we can experience the grace of God when we respond properly to the truth. We can receive mercy from God when we respond properly to the truth. We can experience peace with God and the peace of God that surpasses all understanding when we respond properly to the truth. Amen. That's what Paul in Philippians 4, he says, be careful, don't be anxious about anything. Don't be anxious, don't be worried, don't be fretful about anything. But in everything, in prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, that your request be made known unto God, and the peace of God that passes all understanding should garrison your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. And so it's based on our response to the truth. We will experience the results of responding properly to the truth of the grace of God and the mercy of God and peace with God and peace of God. Look at what else John says. I rejoice greatly. I rejoice greatly. Another result of responding properly to the truth is joy. He says, I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in truth as we have received a commandment from the Father. Now, many of you here this morning are parents. And as you grow older, things that were more important to you when you were younger as parents become less important to you as you grow older as parents, and they become a greater concern that you have for your children that they know the truth and they respond properly to the truth. When they are younger, because by their very age, you are responsible for feeding and clothing and for nurturing and for protecting them. And for the most part, every wakening day, every wakening hour of the day, young children either have parental guidance, either they have teachers, some adult that is responsible for controlling the environment in which they are exposed to. So there's a certain amount of control that adults exert over children when they're younger. But as they become older and they spend less time under the controlling influence of positive adults, it becomes more and more important to us as parents that are teaching the truth. Do they really know the truth? Do they know right from wrong? Have their mind been shaped by the truth where they have a biblical world and life view? So when they start dealing with situations and circumstances out in the world system, hearing ideologies and philosophies, there's enough truth inside of them that will serve as a grid that will allow them to process the things they are hearing, so they will make decisions not based on feelings or emotion, not based on the pressure of the hour, but based on transcendent truth that controls the reins of their conscience. If we might not think it through like that, that's really what we're thinking about. We began to realize that our children are vulnerable to the influences and the devices of an evil world system that is out to lead them down a path away from God, and then we realize how important the truth is. We realize how important the truth is. And I tell you, as one who stands here now, at that point in my own life, as the nest grows toward being empty, you start rethinking, what really have I done with these years? What really have I done with these years in terms of trying to teach my children the truth in a way that they would understand how important this is? It's not just knocking outside the head with the Bible either. You see, it's not that. But it is teaching truth in the context of reality. In the context of reality, in the context of the real world. I had a conversation the other day with a good friend of mine, a member of this church, and I was talking about that. I said, you know, the more I read the Bible, the more amazed I am that Jesus never said to his disciples, guys, get your Bibles and turn down to the book of Leviticus. Get your Bible and turn to 1 Kings, 2 Kings. He never did that. Never did he do that. Not that it wasn't important. Not that he did not, he honored the word of God, because his custom was to go to the synagogue. And most importantly, he honored the word of God because he was the fulfillment of the word of God. But when you look at the life of Jesus, his mission basically was to live the truth in a cultural context, in a historical context, and to live out the truth in everyday life situations. And so what he was always showing them by his actions, that he was committed to the truth. He then would teach the masses in parables, and the parables was always about some earthly situation or circumstance. In the earthly situation or circumstance, force people to look at the reality of the truth. And so we begin to see this in the life of Christ, that he was teaching truth all the time to his disciples. And we learn the truth as we study his life. So John says we respond properly to it. We'll experience the proper results of grace, mercy, and peace, and joy in our lives, and we'll bring joy to the lives of others. And then he also says, verse 5, now beseech thee, lady, not as though I wrote a new commandment unto thee, but that which we have from the beginning, that we love one another. And this is love, that we walk after his commandments. This is the commandment that as you have heard from the beginning, you should walk in it. And so he says, we walk in the truth. And as we walk into the truth, we fulfill the commandment to love each other, to seek each other's highest good, to promote each other's welfare, to desire that each person in the family of God reaches their full potential for the glory of God. So he says we respond to the truth. We experience certain results from responding properly to the truth. And that's very important because of verse 7. That will help us to recognize the enemies of the truth. To recognize the enemies of the truth. And we sometimes view the enemies of the truth as those who are burning up Bibles, those who are cursing at God. Yes, they are enemies of the truth, but they're not the only enemies of the truth. Because Satan will always give us 1,000 pounds of truth, but he might interject just 1 milligram of a lie. And a milligram of a lie, it distorts the truth, and it totally permeates the whole thing. So look at what he says. If we respond properly, we experience the right results, and we'll be able to recognize, verse 7, for many deceivers are entered into the world, who confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. This is the deceiver and an antichrist. We can recognize the enemies of the truth by interrogating them on this issue of what they think about Christ. Who is he? Who is Christ? And one of the things we have to be careful about as Christians is that we don't get hung up on disagreeing with people who disagree with us on issues that are not the essential of the Christian faith. And so we don't disagree with somebody because they are post-tribulation and we are mid-tribulation or whatever on these great theological issues, and we spend all our time arguing over those issues instead of realizing, can we find common ground at the cross? Do we agree on who Jesus is? Do we agree that Jesus Christ was born of the Virgin Mary? Do we agree that he lived a perfectly sinless life? Do we agree that he was God in human form? When you see, as John is writing to the church, he wanted to make sure that they understand, if you understand the fundamental basis of Christianity, if you are anchored there, and if you are sincerely seeking to know God and seeking to live for God and to walk with God, then with the basic fundamental understanding, God can lead you into all truth. I wish I would have been in that. You see, John was writing to folk who were living in and around Ephesus, and there was paganism, there was immorality, there was all types of religion. And John could not send them a volume of theological books and say, read all of these books and you can understand everything that's going on around you. What John could say to them, get yourself anchored in the person of Jesus Christ, that the essence of Christianity is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of the living God, who came in the flesh, lived a perfectly sinless life, was betrayed and crucified, and shed his blood on the cross, who was buried and raised from the dead on the third day. And John said, if you're anchored in him, and if his word abides in you, and the Holy Spirit abides in you, then he will be able to lead you and guide you in all truth. So when I'm not there, John was saying, when I'm not around to guard you, when I'm not around to protect you, when Paul is not there to run interference for you, if you're anchored in Christ for yourself, you'll be armored, you'll be fortified, because you will know in whom you have believed, and you'll know what you have believed, and you will know that greater he is in you than he that is in the world. And so that's why as a church today, we must develop a level a Christianity that has depth in terms of people's personal relationship with Christ. And it cannot be a mere shallow, superficial, emotional, emotional expression of the Christian faith. Yes, there's room for emotionalism. Yes, there's room for shouting and praising God and raising your hands. Yes, there's room for rejoicing. We all rejoice, those of us who know the truth, who love the truth, who are abiding in the truth. Once all the shouting is over with, once all the dancing is done, and once the benediction has been given, and we got to go back to a situation that's difficult and hard, and we got to return to job where we are oppressed or marked or made fun of, or we're treated unfairly, where we got to deal within the context of a community that is at odds with our faith. John says it takes the Holy Spirit leading and guiding us in the truth for us to be relevant to the age and to speak a relevant word, to speak a potent word, to speak a word that basically exposed in the situation and circumstances and that arrests people's attention to the reality that God has spoken.
Well,
so John says that we respond properly, we experience the proper results, and we'll be able to recognize those who are enemies of the truth, those deceivers who deny the incarnation, who deny that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. These are antichrists. And John says it's important that you be able to recognize them, verse 8. Because if you're not, they can rob you of something. Look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time dealing with that, but I believe that John interjects that there by saying, if you allow yourself to be deceived, he did not say that you were going to lose your salvation. But he did say that you can lose a full reward. We can start abiding in Christ, and we can be living for the Lord and be fruitful in our work for the Lord and allow ourselves to be deceived, and we can lose part of all of that reward of faithful devotion to Christ. So he says, look to yourself that you don't get robbed by the deceivers. Verse 9, whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. And so again, this idea of abiding in Christ, and abiding in his word, and abiding in his doctrine. Verse 10, he said, if there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. Let's stop right there. It is interesting when you get into the epistles how much emphasis is placed upon doctrine. How much emphasis is placed upon teaching, because what we are taught, what we learn, and what we believe is going to determine how we think. And what we think, based on what we believe, or based on what we've been exposed to and taught, is going to determine how we respond to certain situations. So he says this, if we recognize the enemies of the truth, then we will know how to relate to those who are enemies of the truth. We will know how to relate to those who are enemies of the truth. And look at what he says again in verse 10. He says, if there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not in your house, and bid him Godspeed. And the doctrine that he was talking about was the doctrine concerning Christ, the person of Christ, the deity of Christ. That is the doctrine John is speaking of. Now, it was customary in their culture, because the church was for the most part convened in people's houses. There were house churches. They didn't have the beautiful edifices that we have built and constructed today, particularly in the Gentile communities. And this was a Gentile audience that John was writing to. And so people would gather together to study the scripture. They would gather together to discuss philosophy. They would gather together to discuss their religion. And so I think that maybe what John is saying here is that we ought to be careful who we allow in our gathering to be in a position of teaching or giving instruction, lest people be misled that we are embracing their doctrine. I don't think that John was saying that you shouldn't talk to people who don't believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. If that's what he's saying, how would we evangelize? Because everybody who's lost don't know the Lord. And And so Christ has given us the mandate that we should go into all the world and preach the gospel, and we should bring people to saving faith in Christ, identify them with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. I don't even think that John was saying here, as a rule, that we should allow people to come into our homes who believe differently from us. If that was the case, then how could we ever entertain strangers? And the Bible instructs us in Hebrews 13, we should entertain strangers because some have entertained angels and didn't know it. And we should be given to hospitality. So we have to be careful in terms of how we interpret this particular passage and what its application is. Because if we're not careful, then what we will do is we will cut ourselves off from most of the unsaved world. And so how do we bring people to saving faith in Christ? I think the key point here is the doctrine. Well, I think what he is suggesting here is that we should not let people come into our homes, set up shop, to teach a doctrine that would be contrary to the doctrine of Christ. We should allow people to come into the church, and since their church is met in homes, and set up their house in our church house and preach a doctrine that is contrary to sound, hygienic, healthy doctrine. I think that's what John is saying. And John is saying we should not lead people to believe that God's blessing is upon them just because they are sincere. We should not lead them to believe that they can believe what they want to believe, teach what they want to teach, and have the blessing of God upon them. Don't give them God's speed or God's blessing when they have rejected the person of Christ. Because the Jews says we are to earnestly to contend for the faith. And in this day and age in which we live, why would we believe that our faith would not be under attack? Why would we believe that just because we live in a quote-unquote educated society, an enlightened society, why do we think that there will not be enemies of the cross of Christ, those who are deceivers, and those who are out to attack and to undermine the Christian faith? And so John is saying to them, and he's saying to us, our response to the truth is very important. Amen. For the church. For what distinguishes the church is that we are the pillar and the ground of the truth. We are the forum for the dissemination of the word of God, for the heralding of the doctrine about Christ, and for calling people to repentance toward God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so John is saying to the elect lady here, which I believe is a congregation whom he had a close relationship with. And John is saying to us, our response to it, our relationship to it, will determine the results and our ability to recognize error in our experiencing joy in our life. Joy in a congregation. Joy in a family. God wants us to have joy. Because the joy that we experience in serving Christ is the fuel that propels us to continue to serve Christ in the midst of difficulty and hardship and pain and suffering and disappointment. It is the joy that we get. It continues to ignite the wick. It continues to serve as a source of fuel that when we don't want to give up, we don't give up. When we want to quit, we don't quit. Because something inside of us continues to resonate with us that we know the truth, we found the truth, and the truth abides in us.
Amen.
And so we continue to persevere.
Amen.
We continue to move on.
Amen.
Well, if you're here this morning, and you've never by faith received Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I will send you an opportunity today. You can come to know the living God through faith in Jesus Christ. It does not matter what you've done, where you have been. It doesn't matter what your socioeconomic status, political affiliation. That God is an equal opportunity Savior.
Amen.
And he sent his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to die a substitutionary death in your place, in my place. To shed his blood on the cross as full payment for the sins of the world. And he was raised from the dead on the third day by the power of Almighty God. And he's ascended to sit at God's right hand. You know the term right hand man? Jesus Christ is God's right hand man. So So he's at God's right hand. And one day he's going to return. He's going to judge the world for rejecting the truth and rejecting his offer of salvation. But now he extends grace and mercy and forgiveness. So if you're here today, you can receive the grace of God and the mercy of God and the forgiveness of God, and you can have your sins forgiven. You can receive salvation today. And we send an opportunity to you. Let's bow together, shall we?